Good morning, and thank you for joining us here at Forest Hill Christian Church for our time of worship together.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing it will be. The victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. Streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Trust in you alone, higher than While you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow.
To the glory of your love, there is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. It's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy.
To you, my King.
King. No one on earth deserves the praises that sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due.
We continue today with a very familiar hymn. We simply call it by one word, doxology. The word doxology comes from two Greek words, in fact, doxa, which means glory, and logos, which means word. So a doxology is literally a word of glory. And we sing doxologies to give glory or praise to God. And there are literally a number of doxologies. Among more familiar doxologies is one that is traditionally used in Roman Catholic worship, for instance, begins with glory to God in the highest and peace to his people on earth. Another familiar doxology that I became acquainted with several years ago, the Gloria Patri, I guess perhaps is how you say it, begins, glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost. But the doxology that we want to consider here is only four lines. It's perhaps more familiar to most of us, at least in the Christian church today. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. But these four lines just might be sung more frequently than any other Christian music. This doxology was written by Thomas Ken, an Anglican clergyman. Ken was born in 1637 and was orphaned at an early age. He then went to live with his half-sister Anne and her husband Isaac Walton. Now, some of you fishermen might recognize Isaac Walton's name because he was the author of The Complete Angler, a book on fishing that quickly established itself as a standard work and ultimately became a classic. It was first published in 1653. That's a long time ago. And you can still, even today, buy a copy of it on Amazon.com. Now, when Ken was 14 years old, he entered Winchester College, and 4 years later, he began studies at Oxford University. He later returned to Winchester College as the chaplain to the bishop. Now, while he was there, he wrote his manual of prayers, if you will, this little book for the use of the scholars of Winchester College, which he first published in 1674. It was a book of prayers for all kinds of occasions, and it included, among many others, a morning prayer and an evening prayer, a prayer to use after committing a sin, a prayer for use when tempted, a prayer entitled Acts of Shame, and another entitled Acts of Abhorrence. Ken also wrote hymns for the students to use to mark the passage of their days, including morning hymn, evening hymn, and a midnight hymn. Both the morning hymn and the evening hymn end with the doxology that begins, praise God from whom all blessings flow. That was the origin of this doxology. Now, Ken established an excellent reputation at Winchester and was eventually appointed chaplain to King Charles II. And when the king decided to visit Winchester, he sent word to Ken that Nell Gwyn, the king's mistress, was to be lodged at Ken's house. Ken not only mounted a loud objection, but also hired workmen to literally remove the roof to his house so that the king could not enforce Nell's lodging there. Now, in that time and place, an act of rebellion against the king could cost a person his head. But King Charles was impressed with Ken's courage. Not only did he allow Ken to live, but he even appointed him sometime later to the bishop of two English provinces. Some years later, Ken was one of seven bishops who refused to sign King James's Declaration of Indulgence. And for this act of rebellion, he was arrested and imprisoned in the Tower of London, in fact. But he was later tried and acquitted. He later died of natural causes in 1711. But it's a great doxology. In fact, another great doxology, if you will, not musically perhaps, but certainly from Scripture, the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3. It's in verse 20 and 21, and we'll look at those verses in a few moments. But Paul started praying for the believers in Ephesus in verse 1 of Ephesians chapter 3, and so it's kind of a prayer for them. And then he broke off into kind of a digression, if you will, in which he talked about the mystery of the gospel, which had been revealed to him, namely that God was making a new family of believers out of those saved Jews and Gentiles. And he was talking about the ministry of the gospel to which God had called him, literally. And then in verse 14, the Apostle Paul got back to praying for the Ephesians. And Paul's prayer for the family of believers in Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14, is really a pretty marvelous prayer consisting of four different petitions. He prayed that the believers would be strengthened with power so they might do all that Christ calls them to do, particularly in dealing with their sin. He also prayed that believers would have Christ dwelling in them so that Christ might make them more and more like him. A third thing he prayed for was that believers would know Christ's love so that they might comprehend, literally, with all the saints, what is the breadth and length and the height and the depth of his love. And finally, Paul petitioned God that believers would be filled with all the fullness of God so that they may know him better and better now and in eternity. And then Paul concluded his prayer with a great doxology. And so I want to read for you from Paul's great doxology here in Ephesians chapter 3. They literally are contained in verse 20 and 21, but for the sake of context, I want to read the entire prayer beginning there in verse 14 of Ephesians chapter 3. And Paul writes this. He says, "For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know that this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever." And then he ends with this simple word that we often end our doxology with, amen. In his commentary on the book of Ephesians, Dr. Brian Chappell tells the following story about a time when he was the president of Covenant Theological Seminary in St. Louis, Missouri. He says, "Some time ago, I needed to make a difficult financial announcement about our seminary because stock market dynamics were creating serious pressures on our finances." He says, "I was stewing about the announcement during my early morning jog around a neighborhood lake." And he says, "Deep in thought, I came to the top of a hill just as some Canadian geese were approaching the lake from the other side of the rise. The result was that for a split second, I found myself face to face with a flying goose. I ducked to my right, but he dodged to his left so that we were still on a collision course. I froze, anticipating the crash of our noggins." He continues to write. He says, "But then In one of those sequences that seems to unfold in slow motion, he tweaked his tail and lifted a leg so that his body twisted, and he went by my shoulder with an outstretched wing grazing the top of my head. Once I realized that I'd been spared, I could not help being a little philosophical. Oh, great, I thought. Wouldn't that have been a sad way to go out? I can imagine the headlines now. Seminary president taken to heaven on the wings of a goose. Though it may seem a bit silly, in a strange way, being saved by that little flick of a goose's tail gave me a great deal of peace that day. He goes on to say, My peace came from considering the protection God provided me on that day. I was so worried about dear friends, the place I serve, and many months of pressure to come. I began to consider what God had to arrange in order to make that split-second event of reassurance happen. What kind of planning did it take for a person raised in Tennessee over 50 years ago and a goose probably hatched in Canada 3 years ago to simultaneously approach a rise in Missouri and come within 2 feet of one another on the very day that I needed encouragement because of a difficult announcement that I had to make as a result of stock market dynamics that had taken years to develop in a worldwide economy? Now think about that. The sequence of plans needed to make all of those events and entities converge is so precisely, is truly mind-boggling. The wisdom and power of God that made that goose's tail twitch at the precise moment needed to fan into flame a flicker of hope in me, he says. They were beyond anything I could ask or even think. He says, in conclusion, in a world that whirls in an endless procession of unpredictable events and personal challenges, we lose track of what God does moment by moment to preserve us and His purposes for our lives. All we know that our God loves us, but amidst the pressures of rents to pay and jobs to perform and medical results to wait, tests to take and transitions to make, we wonder still, is our God able to help me here today? You see, the Bible's message of a sovereign God who rules over things in all places, among all people, for all eternity, calms our heart and stimulates our prayers with the simple affirmation, He is able. Now, Paul's doxology to conclude his prayer in Ephesians chapter 3 is a powerful affirmation about the greatness of God. And so we picked up there in verses 20 and 21 of Ephesians chapter 3, and it shows us the greatness of God. And I want us to look at that for just a few moments together today. First of all, what is God able to do? Well, let's first ask that question. Paul noted that God is able to do two things. God is able to do, first of all, more than we ask. The first part of verse 20 says, He's able to do more than we ask. Now to Him who is able to do more abundantly than all that we ask. There's only one word in the Greek text, and I'm not even going to begin to try to pronounce it for you, for what is translated in English as far more abundantly. It means literally an extraordinary degree, involving a considerable excess over what would be expected. So the Apostle Paul literally is saying, God is able to do considerably more than all we ask. Our prayers are so small sometimes, aren't they? We ask for success when we really need humility. We ask for security when we really need boldness. Comfort when we really need character. We ask for health when we really need holiness. We ask for what we think is best for us, but God, in his marvelous grace, is able to give us far more than all that we ask. He knows what will make us more like Christ in our walk with Him. Brian Chappelle, in his commentary, tells the story about a childless woman named Mary Nelson. It was in 1983, and Mary was working in her garden in St. Louis, and she was praying while she worked, and she asked God to to help not only in her grief for the absence of children in her life, but also in her bitter awareness then of women who could have children, but over and over again chose to abort them. The absence of a child in her home created such a longing for life in her heart that Mary asked God there in the garden that day to help her give life to children in whatever way he would lead. 9 months later, Mary gave birth to the first pregnancy resource center in St. Louis. And since that time, literally thousands of children have been spared due to the prayers and the labors of Mary Nelson and others who have followed her. She, who once asked to be a life-giving mother to one, has become life-saving mother to thousands. You see, God is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask. A second way, though, that God does that is he is able to do more than we even think. The latter half of that verse, Paul said, "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think or imagine." That's staggering to think about that concept. Not only is God able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask, he is in fact able to do more abundantly than all that we can even think. I wonder how often has God done something in your life and you have not even thought about it? I mean, who even thinks about, I don't know, getting cancer? But God in his infinite wisdom allows cancer because he's working all things together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Remember Romans chapter 8, verse 28. As Brian Chappell says, God's greatness allows me to believe in his goodwill, even when something I ask for is not answered when I desire it or how I think. God's greatness is always designed for his glory and our good. God is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or even think. So then, how is God able to do it? Well, we're in our same verses there in verse 20 and 21, in the kind of the midpoint, if you will, verse 20. That second question becomes for us as we think about how can he do it. Paul showed us that God is able to do it in two different ways. He's able to do it sovereignly. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power, or as the New International Version puts it, according to his power. God's power is, in a word, immense. In fact, God is all powerful. He is supremely powerful. How powerful is God? Well, God spoke the entire universe into existence. He merely said, and as is recorded in Genesis chapter 1, "Let there be light." And there was light. He said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters," and it separated the waters from the waters, and there was heaven, and so on. God's power worked in the lives of Abraham and Sarah and Moses and Gideon and David and Elijah and Isaiah and Nehemiah and the people of Israel. God's covenant was moving forward step by step toward the arrival of his promised Messiah. And God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to be born of a virgin named Mary. And eventually, Jesus was crucified. But God's power raised him back to life 3 days later. You know what? God's power is still working today as more than 2 billion people have been regenerated by him. The church of Jesus Christ is expanding, and the gates of hell shall not overcome it. So, friends, here's what I need you to hear. God is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think because he is able to use his sovereign power to accomplish what he wants to do. But God is also able to do it personally. Paul said in verse 20, the very last part of verse 20, "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power," listen, "at work within us." This is something that literally ought to cause us to rejoice. God does not work in what we would call impersonal ways. Instead, his sovereign power, all of that mighty power we just spoke about, is at work within us. I wonder today, do you believe that? I wonder, do you recognize that? You know, it seems to me in our world, in our culture, maybe especially today, we love heroes. We look at heroes not only in the world around us, but we look at heroes of the faith, people like R.C. Sproul or Jonathan Edwards or Amy Carmichael or Elizabeth Elliot, and we have no trouble believing that God is at work within them. We see those lives, we read their stories, and we recognize that. Now, that's when we have trouble believing that God and his word, when we wonder, but God at work within us? We have trouble with believing that one sometimes. But think of a woman at the crisis pregnancy center counseling a young teenager, maybe not to abort her baby. A dad who teaches young children in a Sunday school class what it means to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. A wife who has determined to love her husband even though he has betrayed her love through adultery. A man who refuses to be dishonest in his work despite his boss's pressure to do so. A woman who plays music to enable God's people to worship well despite her own back pain. You see, from their perspective, they may not believe that God is at work within them. But friends, let me tell you, God is powerfully at work within them. God is powerfully at work in every Christian who lives in obedience to God and to his word. So, how is God able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or even think? Well, he's able to do so according to his power at work within us. He is able to do so sovereignly and personally. A third question, though, and our final question, literally, is why is God able to do it? Well, Paul stated that God was able to do it for two reasons. God is able to do it to be glorified in the church. First, God is able to do it to be glorified in the church. And Paul says it there in the latter half of verse 21, "To him be glory in the church." You see, the church is of course, the fellowship in which God is gathering believers from every corner on earth together. The church is God's chosen instrument through which his purposes for this earth and for eternity are accomplished. It is in the church where people come to know Christ, and they come to grow in Christ, and they come to serve Christ, and they come to share Christ, and they come to worship Christ. Now, I know things are odd in our season of COVID, and I'm not talking about the church being the four walls of the building that we come together in. I'm talking about the church being the body of Christ, the believers who unite together in mind, heart, and spirit. Jesus Christ himself said, "I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." You see, God will glorify himself in the church because God's sovereign power is at work within each believer. And then God is able to do it to be glorified in Christ Jesus. The latter half of verse 21, Paul said, "To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus." You see, God will be glorified not only in the church, but he will also be glorified in his Son, Jesus Christ. John Stott, in a commentary, says it this way, the power comes from him. The glory must go to him. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus together, in the body and in the head, in the bride and in the bridegroom, in the community of peace and in the peacemaker. Moreover, this morning, God will be glorified as Paul says, throughout all generations. That is, in history. And then he says, forever and ever, and that's in eternity. Throughout all generations, forever and forever, and he closes with amen. You know, as we look at and as we learn from Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 and 21, let's praise God for his greatness. I want to close with this story. I've mentioned the commentator Brian Chappell, and he tells this story as he writes. He says, as this year's Thanksgiving service, I listened as the wife of one of our preachers gave glory to God. She spoke in the light of the recent murder of her brother. For some years, this brother had lived in rebellion against God, he says, but through the witness of his family and others, a glorious transformation had occurred. She reported how her brother had one day come to her father and said, "Now I know where I am going and whom I trust." After that, the brother changed, and the circumstances surrounding that change were already more than the family could ask or think. God had worked sovereignly and personally to bring the young man to himself. After so much pain, before knowing the joy of his salvation, one would think that the murder of this young man would totally devastate his loving family. And of course, in many ways, it did. But this dear sister, he writes, he says, reported how after her brother's death, and even while her father held his dead son in his arms, the father said that he was at peace. He knew that God had preserved the son until the time that his eternity was secure with the Lord. But even this promise of eternity was not all that caused the sister to rise to her feet to give glory to God. In fact, she rose to her feet to give glory to God that her family was now praying for the salvation of the man who had murdered her brother. The Lord is using the family of a man recently saved to pray for the eternity of the man who killed him. Is this senseless? Well, to the world, yes, it is. It's even more than I would normally ask or think could be right. But in the church, and for those who are in Christ Jesus, such amazing love is just another reason to give glory to God. For we know it is literally more evidence that he is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. We give him glory today, not only because he's able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, but also because in Jesus Christ, we know that our God is willing to give supernatural blessing so that there will be glory due him in the church and in Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Ooh, 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 ooh. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thanks again for joining us here at Forest Hill Christian Church for our time of worship today. We trust you'll be back again. Thanks for joining us. We're going to invite you right now, if you would, to join us in prayer. God, we just come into your presence and we thank you so much for your loving kindness, your care and provision, Father, that sustain us, your Spirit that indwells us, the power of Jesus through the cross of Calvary that provides life everlasting to us. And so, Father, today we come with the burdens of this life and we leave them at the foot of the cross. We pray, Father, that you would give us the wisdom to leave them there and not to pick them back up. Father, thank you for loving us, caring for us, providing a way for us to an everlasting home with you. Father, we're anxious for that day. We look forward to sharing our eternity with you. And Father, would you help us then with that same zeal and excitement to share that story with others so they too might know that hope and assurance and eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.